Welcome to Deaf Mosaic. I'm your host, Gil Eastman. Many of you probably remember the television production of Love Is Never Silent, which was broadcast last year, starring two deaf actors, Phyllis Freilich and Ed Waterstreet. It was the story of the relationship between deaf parents and their hearing daughter.
Calm down.
Help. Will somebody call her daughter so that we can find out what's going on?
On paydays, I would always bring my daughter with me. She's hearing. She spoke my words. She was my ears. She was a little girl, and whenever there were problems, she had to fight for me. Caught in between, my Margaret.
Juliana Field, a deaf actress and producer, struggled for 10 years to get Hollywood to produce the program. Recently, her efforts were rewarded with television's greatest honor, an Emmy Award for Best Dramatic Program. It's the first time that a deaf person has won a National Emmy Award. We're honored to have Juliana Field with us. Here's Jane Norman to talk with her.
You've now won the top award given in the television business. You've won the Emmy. How do you feel?
It was a real mind-blowing experience. I remember that moment when Linda Evans announced the winner. Once she said, "Love is never..." I saw nothing after that. My mind was blown. I don't remember anything. No form in front of my eyes. I just did what my heart said do. Get up, walk to the stage, be there to give a speech. But we didn't. It was a wonderful experience.
How will winning this Emmy help you with future television projects?
The door is open. It will not shut. That's the biggest difference. Before winning the Emmy, I had to knock on doors. Sometimes the doors would open just a crack, then shut. Other times the doors opened wide, but would later close. But now, after winning the Emmy, the door is open and will always be open. So it's up to me to go through the door with whatever attitude I have and how I present the project to those people. Will I have more patience with them or not? I don't know. This is a new experience for me. I'm walking on eggshells right now to convey the right message. That's a big difference. Open doors. When I pick up the phone or use TDD or have an interpreter place a call, I ask for a meeting. It's yes in no time. It's not, well, I don't have time, later, maybe in a week or two. When I ask for a certain date, that's it. That's a big step for me.
What is it like to work as a producer? What's involved? What do you do?
It's a beautiful experience. For one thing, you have all the power. You decide what you want to do. With respect. If you're a bad producer, it's goodbye. So I happen to know that I'm okay as a producer. I treated people equally with respect. If I don't understand what is going on in some situation, I ask the right person and get the right information. Thank God for that. There is no ego problem. If you have ego problems, it's goodbye. I'm not interested in working with you. So I learned, as a producer, to deal with people. From camera person to the president of the USA, if necessary. You must know how to communicate with them properly. And when you get their respect, respect them back. When you start off like that, you can accomplish whatever it is you want to do. My own experience with Love Is Never Silent was to decide on the deaf issues. I did not speak for deaf people, but at the same time, I did speak for deaf people. I had to be careful, like walking on eggshells. I had to decide which line was more appropriate for deaf people, what they would most likely say. I'm from a hearing family. I'm not a native deaf person, but I am a deaf person. So I had to get other deaf people included and get their input. The movie people listened. Now about money. For example, I had to negotiate with interpreters about how much money we would pay them. And script development involves money. You have to weigh everything. It's very expensive to have deaf people involved in a project. Yet at the same time, it's very cheap. As a producer, you have to know, have to see how things go, oversee everything. Then script development. Yes, there are a lot of locking of horns because this is where the show begins. The film, movie, originates from the script. The script is where the power is.
Do you think that now, with the release of Children of a Lesser God, and before that, Love is Never Silent, deaf involvement in films, which has always been quite limited, do you think it will increase or decrease?
Increase. Definitely increase. Because what happened, honestly, after we won the Emmy for Best Picture, a lot of technical opportunities opened up for deaf actors. I mean, people, not actors. Cameramen, gophers. Many interviews were held that week. Surprising. Many people were willing to have deaf people involved. As for acting, no, not enough. Not well known.
Juliana, you're in the spotlight after winning the Emmy. Now you're in the fast lane. What is your life like now? Any love interest?
Really, many people thought I would change because of the Emmy and all that. My answer is N-O, a big no. I'm the same old Juliana with my scooter at home that I use for transportation. One funny thing happened when I went up to get my Emmy. Yes, it was a dream, our American dream. I didn't realize I was there until I got home. The next morning, I saw the Emmy on my desk. I wondered, what's that doing there? I had to see the videotape again and again to believe that I was there. To this day, I can't believe I was there. I laugh every time I see it because it is so unreal. The next day after the Emmy Award, know what I did? I got on my scooter, went to a coffee shop, sat down, and enjoyed my coffee.
Thank you very much.
Juliana has really opened the door to Hollywood for deaf people. Congratulations, Juliana. Last month, Legal Corner discussed tenants' rights. Now, for part two of that series.
When you rent an apartment, you are a tenant, and you have certain rights. But as a deaf tenant, you may have other special rights that you should know about. Some states require that landlords must provide deaf tenants with a visual fire alarm. These state laws require that the deaf tenant write a letter to the landlord requesting a visual smoke alarm. The landlord is allowed to ask for a security deposit for the alarm. In some states, the law protects deaf tenants who have hearing ear dogs. In these states, the deaf tenant can keep the dog even if the lease says no pets. Check to see if your state has this kind of law. Remember, if you're not sure what to do, ask.
In the 1970s, many deaf residential schools saw their student populations more than triple because of the rubella bulge. Now, some of those schools are facing record lows in the number of students. The increase in the enrollment of deaf children in mainstream programs also means less enrollment in the residential schools. Many deaf people worry about the educational and cultural impact this will have on the deaf community. But Deaf Mosaic has discovered another important issue, the economic impact on the small towns where many of the deaf schools have been located for many years. Deaf Mosaic sent producer Mary Lou Novitsky to one such town to investigate.
People in big cities are different from the people in small towns like this one. The people here are more easygoing. Life is simpler, everyone knows each other, and they enjoy having a good chat. This is Cave Spring, Georgia. The Deaf Mosaic crew came here to find out more about a very special story. A story about the relationship between the deaf and the hearing people. This small community in northeast Georgia has a population of 883 people, one traffic light, and one of the oldest residential schools for the deaf in the country, the Georgia School for the Deaf. Mayor Earl Russell explains a little local history.
The most of the people in Cave Springs has moved to Cave Springs from other areas in the state of Georgia because they've had deaf children in their family to go to school here. After they moved here, they found out it's the best place in Georgia, so they stayed.
It's even hard to separate the identity of the town from the identity of the school. And although the number of students has dropped from a high of 700 to an average of 175, the school is still a driving force here, politically, socially, and economically.
The Georgia School for the Deaf is the major employer in the community of Cave Springs. We have a budget of over $5 million, of which a lot stays in the community here. As far as I'm concerned, the future of GSD is favorable. We've been here for over 130 years, and as far as I know, we'll be here for another 130 years plus. There will always be a place in the state of Georgia for a residential school for hearing impaired students. That does not mean that we will not have to gear up for some multiply handicapped hearing impaired or some other populations, but there will always be a need for a residential school, in my opinion.
How has more than a century of deaf presence here affected the community? What do the deaf students experience when they go into town? You are enrolled here at GSD in Cave Spring. Sometimes after classes are over and you need a break, you might see a movie or go to a restaurant, maybe shopping, buy candy. I'm curious, the people in town I know can fingerspell or sign a little, but how do you communicate with the townspeople?
I might be talking with someone and someone else sees me and asks me how they can learn sign language, so I teach them. First I write to them, then teach them fingerspelling, then they get more experienced.
Cave Spring is not just a town of hearing people who have learned to accept deaf students. Cave Spring is a town of deaf adults, too, who take an active role in their community.
The deaf adults who work in the school or live in town often take part in community activities, such as recreational activities and summertime programs for the hearing and deaf children in town. They serve in church and teach Sunday school and things like that to the deaf children who come from the school. They take part in the political process. Most of the adults I know are voters, and they take part in elections each time we have one.
The mayor and the city council and the community itself is very supportive of the school. 90% of the people in the town know some sign language, are very willing to adjust to our students and assist us in any way they can. It's, like I said, you couldn't ask for a better community to be in. Can I help you?
During my stay here, I found that it is not unusual for a shopkeeper to know a few signs. I asked the mayor what would happen to Cave Spring if the school were to close down.
I'd rather not even think about that. It would probably fold up. As you can tell, we're a small town, and our biggest base of income is from the Georgia School for the Deaf.
For now, the future of the Georgia School for the Deaf seems secure. But there are rumors that deaf residential schools may be closing for many different reasons, like mainstreaming or financial difficulties. It's important to remember, though, that many small towns are economically dependent on the schools for the deaf that are nearby. If a residential school closes, it will mean the classrooms will be empty. But it is also possible that you will see the town empty too.
The classrooms in the residential schools are really special for deaf children. Our deaf portrait is also about education. It's about a man who was himself a pioneer in deaf education more than a century ago.
My name is Melvin Ballard. When I was 9 years old and didn't know how to read or write, I learned by observation. I was convinced that in the evening, the sun jumped into a hole in the earth and through a giant tube raced back east to rise again the next day. When I was 11, my parents sent me to the American School for the Deaf, where I learned about the sun, the moon, the stars, and a lot more. I became a teacher myself, and Edward Minor Gallaudet asked me to join him in Washington, D.C. to teach children at the Columbia Institute for the Deaf. 3 years later, Gallaudet opened the National Deaf Mute College on the same campus, and I enrolled. Initially, I was the only student. Within 2 years, I earned a Bachelor of Science degree, and I am honored to be the first graduate of the first college for deaf people.
It's official. After 120 years, Gallaudet College has become Gallaudet University. The world's only liberal arts college for the deaf has become a full university, serving deaf students and the deaf community throughout the world. The students, faculty, staff, alumni, and friends of Gallaudet mark this achievement with a week-long series of seminars, lectures, sports events, and homecoming parades, and, of course, a formal academic convocation to make the change official. It was a week for Gallaudet to shine, to be proud of all the things it has been and all the things it hopes to be in the future. Join us now for some highlights from Gallaudet's University Week. A celebration of learning was the theme of the week-long festival of events that marked Gallaudet College's transition to university status. Rain couldn't dampen the spirits of Gallaudet students and alumni as the Bison triumphed in the homecoming game.
All right.
Entertainment, friendship, and barbecue were enjoyed by faculty and staff at the University Week Festival, held on a warm fall afternoon. Meanwhile, prep students at Gallaudet's Northwest Campus enjoyed captioned music videos as they danced throughout the evening. Hughes Gymnasium was transformed into an elegant banquet hall for the faculty lecture and luncheon, featuring a former CBS News executive. Among the many lectures and events held during the week was a discussion of deaf images in film and TV by history professor Dr. John Shookman. The topic stimulated active discussion among the audience. University Week also celebrated the publication of the Gallaudet Encyclopedia of Deaf People and Deafness, a comprehensive three-volume set. Gallaudet University dedicated its new Athletic Hall of Fame with the induction of John Ringel, class of 1933. The high point of the week was the formal convocation, during which Gallaudet College officially became Gallaudet University. An overflow crowd came to recognize the university and the special accomplishments of some of its more distinguished members.
I take great pleasure in presenting the Power AV Doctor Medallion for International Service to Dr. Mervyn Garrison, a very special assistant to the president of Gallaudet University.
Now the moment has come
for Gallaudet College to enter a new era of teaching, learning, research, service, and leadership. It is with great pleasure and high honor, on behalf of the Board of Trustees, to proclaim hereby that this institution shall be officially designated Gallaudet University.
Now we are happy to have with us Dr. Jerry C. Lee, the president of Gallaudet University. Gallaudet College is now Gallaudet University. Does this major change mean there will be more changes to come?
Well, you're right. It is a major change. It represents the progress that Gallaudet University has made during the past 122 years, but also represents the quality of our academic programs, the significance of our research efforts, and the impact our outreach programs have nationally and internationally.
How will Gallaudet University help deaf people to become more aware of opportunities in education and employment? What improvements do you have planned that will benefit deaf people?
Well, Gallaudet's basic purpose is to provide exemplary education opportunities to deaf students, to prepare them for careers after Gallaudet, to help them become all they're capable of being. That is our goal.
The word university has come to mean a place where there is a strong emphasis on research, graduate school programs, and teaching. Gallaudet, in the past, was primarily an undergraduate school with some research and graduate programs in education, linguistics, child development, and so forth. Which programs are you planning to expand, the graduate school or research?
In the area of research, Gallaudet today conducts the world's most extensive research in the field of deafness, and we'll continue that. Additionally, we plan to increase the number of programs at the graduate level, especially at the PhD and the MA and the MS.
Recently, you established a school of management here. Would you describe briefly that program?
Well, I'm very excited about the program. It's been one of my dreams since becoming president. Several years ago, Gallaudet conducted a survey of its alumni, and we found that the salaries of our male graduates were a lot less than the comparable salaries of hearing men. And one reason is that our male graduates tend not to go into business, into management. We need to change that and provide our men and women with opportunities to go into management and develop their skills so they can successfully compete. Later, we hope to see deaf people earn as much as hearing people.
The emphasis in America is now more and more on mainstreaming. There is talk that Gallaudet will become mainstreamed. As an example, Gallaudet has admitted hearing students. What effect will these hearing students have on the deaf students? If there is a leader among the deaf students and hearing students come along, will deaf leadership continue? Sign language has always been an important part of Gallaudet. Will that continue?
Well, Gallaudet has historically been known as the educational center for deaf people throughout the world. That will continue. We're not going to change that. But we think it's appropriate now to begin to accept, on a limited number, several hearing students who are interested in a career related to deafness. We believe that Gallaudet University is the best place in the world for a hearing person who's interested in working with deaf people. The leadership in the deaf community will continue to come from Gallaudet University.
In the time since you became the president of Gallaudet, I'm sure you have a lot of memories. Could you choose one funny incident and tell us about it?
Well, you're right, Gil. There have been many, many funny things during the years. I guess one that comes to my mind most recently is I met a man who had met each president of Gallaudet, each one including Dr. Edward Minor Gallaudet. The man's name was Mr. Craven. and he met everyone, and he was describing for me the personalities, the characteristics of each president. I won't describe what he said, but it was really humorous to see what he had to say about each of Gallaudet University's presidents.
Now we'd like to show some highlights from one of the week's many events, the gala. The formal dance celebrated Gallaudet finally becoming a university. But before we run the tape, would you tell us what for you was the most exciting moment of University Week?
Well, during the week, there were many exciting moments for me. First, when I received the honorary doctorate, that was a very exciting time. Giving Dr. Gerritsen the Parry V Doctor Medallion was equally exciting. But perhaps the most important moment for me personally and professionally was the moment that the chairman of the Board of Trustees declared Gallaudet University.
Thank you, Dr. Lee.
Thank you, Gil.
Now, let's watch the videotape. A wonderful time was had by everyone that night. That's our Deaf Mosaic for this month. We'll be right here again next month with new people to meet and new stories about our deaf world. I'm Gil Eastman. So long.